Belinda and Harper Audio Australia present this unabridged recording of One Bright Moon, written by Andrew Kwong and read by Jason Chong. The dedication reads, I dedicate this book with much gratitude and love to the memory of my mama Wei Sing Young and Baba Shek Tong Kwong, who endured the utmost pain as parents, watching their family being torn apart, yet who, with fortitude, perseverance, and amazing grace, ensured the family's final reunion. Also, with much appreciation, to the memory of Brother Casimir, principal of La Salle College, Kowloon, Hong Kong, who gave me the courage I needed to navigate the world. With all my love, to my children Serena, Harmony, and Andrew James. The love of a parent is forever. And last but not least, to my seven little Australians, Bruno, Louis, Clementine, Charlie, Fleur, Henry, and Felix. For you are the reason I wrote this book. Historical timeline. . 1911, Sun Yat-sen leads overthrow of Qing Dynasty. 1912, founding of the Republic of China. 1921, establishment of the Communist Party of China. 1927, beginning of Chinese civil war between communist and nationalist government. 1928, Chiang Kai-shek becomes leader of nationalist government. 1934, communist forces escape nationalist encirclement and undertake a 9,000-kilometer retreat to northern China, the so-called Long March. 1935, Mao Zedong becomes leader of the Communist Party. 1937 to 1945, Second Sino-Japanese War. 1946, resumption of Chinese Civil War. 1949, Mao declares victory and founds the People's Republic of China. 1951 to 1952, the three anti and five anti campaigns urge Chinese people to rid themselves of bourgeois capitalist elements. 1953 to 1957, first five-year plan begins modernization and industrialization of Chinese economy. 1956, Hundred Flowers campaign encourages citizens to express their opinions of the communist regime. 1957 to 1959, anti-rightist campaign initiates a purge of rightist, that is, anti-communist elements from society. 1958 to 1962, second five-year plan or Great Leap Forward, Mao's campaign to collectivize and industrialize the agrarian economy leads to widespread famine. 1958. Citizens encouraged to kill rats, mosquitoes, flies, and sparrows under the Four Pests campaign. 1966. In Australia, Harold Holt's government markedly reduces restrictions on non-European immigration. 1966 to 1976. The Cultural Revolution, aimed at further eliminating bourgeois elements from society, leads to mass persecution of intellectuals in China. 1967. Pro-communist activists riot and plant bombs in Hong Kong. 1971. China joins the United Nations. 1972. US President Richard Nixon visits China. 1973. In Australia, Gough Whitlam's Labor government officially ends the White Australia policy. 1976, death of Mao Zedong. 1978, Deng Xiaoping becomes head of Chinese government. 1980, one-child policy introduced in China. 1989, Tiananmen Square protests in Beijing lead to killing of hundreds of protesters by Chinese military. Australian Prime Minister Bob Hawke responds by granting asylum to 42,000 Chinese students living in Australia. Prologue. Sixteenth day, third lunar month, 1894. In Shenmingting, a small town situated in the vast estuary of the Po River in Guangdong, my great-grandfather Fu Chu awaits his bride. He strolls around the large courtyard of his ancestral home, where more than 20 tables stand ready to seat relatives and distinguished guests. The table and guests spread onto his cousin's front yard next door. Both houses have been splashed with a good coat of whitewash to conceal the aging grey bricks of the otherwise handsome homes. Days before the happy occasion, the painters had been about to brush over the decorative panels beneath the eaves of the two houses when Fu Chu's father had intervened.
"Stop!" he shouted at them, aghast at their ignorance. "Leave them alone. Those are story panels."
The panels depicted many Chinese legends that had captured the imaginations of past generations and would do the same for generations to come. He'd made sure they were safe before directing other servants and helpers who were putting the final touches to the wedding preparations. On either side of the courtyard gates and at the back of the houses, incense sticks burn and paper money has been left out as offerings to the door gods and other supernatural guardians who, in return, it is hoped, will protect the household. The offerings are also made to repel the ghosts that are said to wander constantly, seeking souls to take their place in the spirit world and free them to be reborn and reach enlightenment. First and foremost, the aim is to ensure the smooth execution of the important day. Fu Chu mingles with the guests, and to ease his nerves, takes deep breaths of the abundant smoke lingering in the sweet-scented spring air. He turns back to look at the panels and is pleased his father chose to keep them, even though their colors have faded under the subtropical sky. Much to his delight, they break the sterile monotony of white paint and preserve the vivacity of the life he has known. The image of the exuberant General Guanggong on the panel depicting events from the 14th century historical novel Romance of the Three Kingdoms is his favorite. How fondly he remembers the tale told to him by his father, who in turn had been told it by his father. Such was Guanggong's courage and loyalty in leading the forces of Li Ban, founder of one of the Three Kingdoms in the 3rd century AD, that he later became not just a folk hero, but a god for the Chinese people. From the panel, he seems to beam approval on the family's important day. The tension eases inside Fu Chu. Because he has just turned 20, the coming of age for Chinese men, it is fitting that Fu Chu be married. He has never met his bride-to-be. He doesn't even know her name. While he was away attending high school, the village go-between was arranging a suitable marital candidate for him under his father's instruction. The process of choosing a wife has remained much the same since his ancestors arrived from the north. People do not marry someone from the same village in case the potential spouse is a descendant of shared forebears who fled the onslaught of the mighty Mongol armies 1,000 years earlier. The expertise of the go-between is important for her intimate knowledge of the many families in the surrounding area. Gossip, hearsay, facts, half-truths, and, of course, family trees all help her to assess her clients' backgrounds and ensure a good fit. When the go-between enters a matchmaking deal, her vivid and creative imagination, coupled with a keen sense of how well partners will suit each other, is put into play to ensure success. The bride-to-be must not only be obedient, attentive, and devoted, but also beautiful, virtuous, and able to produce healthy children. As for the potential groom, he should, of course, be handsome, intelligent, and rich. And if he is not wealthy yet, he will be one day,
as predicted by her fortune-telling skills. Fu Chu accepts this way of finding a wife, but he is also a modern young man. A few years attending a progressive high school in the big city of Guangzhou has opened his mind to the possibilities of an expanding universe and life beyond the walls that surround his ancestral home. He now sports a smart Harris tweed waistcoat over his traditional wedding gown of fine black linen, which reaches down to his shiny black shoes. Befittingly, atop his thick dark hair, tamed by imported hair cream, is a Western-style hat, a gift from his father's cousin in San Francisco. Gone is his long pigtail, even though some young men in town still keep theirs. Instead of the traditional ball of red ribbons fashioned into a big round bouquet attached to the middle of his chest, he has a smart gold watch secured to the left pocket of his waistcoat. The matching chain trails from his top button in a gentle curve. He is a new type of groom in Shenmingting, a prosperous little town made wealthier, still by money sent back by the sojourners, the many men who have left China to seek their fortunes in places such as California, known since the gold rush as the Old Gold Mountain, and Australia, the New Gold Mountain. An exodus that has steadily increased since the defeats of the Opium Wars and the subsequent influx of traders telling tales of riches to be found overseas. It is now well past the third hour after noon, the most auspicious hour for the wedding ceremony to begin. The soft sun above the courtyard has tilted to one side, losing much of its glare. Drums, gongs, and trumpets that will herald the bridal procession from 1,000 paces are silent. Fu Chu glances at the long red strings of firecrackers that hang high on strong bamboo poles, ready to ignite. He takes his fob watch from his pocket, flicks open the golden cover, and notes the late hour while reminding himself that patience is a virtue. Waves of murmuring begin to ebb and swirl among the guests, like the sounds of the receding tide in the nearby Qijiang or Wando River, one of the many tributaries that feeds into the Pearl River as it approaches the South China Sea. Perhaps it is best if a messenger is sent to find out what's causing the delay. The messenger soon returns with news. One of the two poles of the bridal sedan has snapped, and the bride has stumbled out. The silk scarf covering her face has flown off, exposing a sad maiden with full lips and features as pretty as the moon. Her red and gold wedding gown has been stained, and her dainty feet, so carefully bound for the past 16 springs by her parents for her big day, have pushed through her fine, embroidered wedding shoes. It is a sorry scene. Passers-by are shaking their heads in disbelief. The musicians have stopped playing, and the porters are too upset by the misfortune to carry on. It is a bad omen. The chirpy sparrows flitting to and fro around the courtyard become still. The women of the family rush forward to burn more incense sticks to appease the door gods and other guardian spirits. Children offer more paper money to pacify the wandering ghosts. Fu Chu, his father, the family elders, and the go-between congregate in the inner room of the house. A decision is needed immediately. "The wedding cannot go on," declares the most senior relative. The glow on his face has vanished. "It is not good for the family." He shakes his head and wipes away pearls of sweat that are rare on a fine spring day. "How do you feel about this?" Fu Chu's father asks his son. The trembling go-between lifts her head and shifts her gaze to the young man. Fu Chu feels the watch ticking in his pocket. Head down, he ponders his father's question for a while. But the future of the maiden weighs more heavily on his mind than the embarrassment to the family. Still burdened by many rituals, traditions, and superstitions, his world doesn't seem to be changing fast enough. Maybe this is not meant to be, my son, his father consoles him. We have underestimated the might of ghostly forces. Perhaps we have angered our ancestors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.